Good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining on the day two of the solar workshop. So yesterday we learned on the basics of the solar panels, technical parameters, inclinations. So we'll wait for one more minute till everybody joins, and then we will start the session. Till then, you can write some specific keywords what you have learned yesterday. And participants who have missed out yesterday, I have also shared you the distinct video recordings of yesterday's session into small session one and session two. I'm just giving you the brief what we have seen yesterday. I'm just running through the slides what we have seen yesterday. And there were two questions which I've asked yesterday, which I'll clarify, and then we'll begin the today's session. MPPT is around maximum 30% more efficient than the PWM charge controllers. So we have almost 17 participants now. So we'll start the session. Am I audible, right? Clear. Can you just type it in the chat box if I'm audible? We welcome all the participants. Thank you, Mr. Manav. Thank you, Mr. Arisha. Thank you. We welcome all the participants for joining on the day two. Now, just to brief you, what we have learned yesterday, we have learned all the solar basics, and there were two specific questions. One question was, in the off-grid system, do we have to calculate the load, battery as a load, so that the charging of the battery happens from the solar panels? Yesterday we have seen only the load calculation, not on the battery calculation. Yes, the answer is yes. If you are charging the battery from the solar panels, you have to consider battery as a load, and suitably you have to increase the solar panels. So yesterday we arrived at 1.7 kilowatt based on the load, right? So let's say we have 150H two batteries, so I would suggest go for a 2 kilowatt system. So always consider extra solar panels to charge the battery as well. Point one. Point two, yesterday there was a question from a member from USolar from Bangalore on the net metering policy in Karnataka. Is the member here who asked? Anybody from Karnataka, you can unmute yourself. Okay, not able to find him, so we'll discuss on today's agenda. Today we are going to talk about the solar on-grid system, which is very different from an off-grid system. Here we don't have the storage facility. The solar panel gets connected to the grid inverter, and it gets synchronized with the incoming EV supply. And through the net metering process, we have the option of exporting this extra power, if it's not utilized inside the building, to your MES. And later it could be adjusted again to units, if it's under net metering concept, or if it's under gross metering concept, then whatever you exported the power out, it will be adjusted against some unit rate against your bill. So the on-grid power plants would not work when there's a power cut. Let's say you have a single phase inverter and a single phase synchronized with a single phase line. It could be RYB of any component. If this R phase, the synchronized phase is failed, the system will get automatically switched off. So it doesn't work during a power cut. That's the drawback of the on-grid system. And with respect to the space area on the terrace, it's almost like 60 to 80 square feet per kilowatt. And it could always synchronize with your diesel generators or a two times, three times higher capacity of inverter backup. Typical price range for such plants is somewhere around, it has come down. It works from 45,000 to 80,000 based on the kilowatt we are talking about. Higher the kilowatt, the cost will be lesser. So let's see, what is the current Tamil Nadu net metering policy? Is anybody aware about the policy? Can we have some quick answers in the chat box? The sad part is there's no net metering. So that was a big change in Tamil Nadu. In 2019, we had this called net feed-in or gross feed-in. So there's no more unit-to-unit adjustment. So net feed-in is the policy. The exported power, now it is getting paid at 2 rupees 8 paisa per unit. And one good thing is it's allowed for all the LT meters for the rooftops and for all the tariffs. So this is the current policy. And we did had a change from the central government starting of the year in 2021. There was a gazette where net metering will be allowed for all plant size below 10 kilowatt and gross metering for all above 10 kilowatt. But that specific policy is on hold. It's not yet implemented. So we would wait what happens from the government side with respect to the net metering or gross metering policy. So till then, whatever was the previous policy of your state, that holds good. So let's understand the flow of power from a grid tie system. So let's say your house is running a load of 1 kilowatt and your generation from the solar panels is 2 kilowatt. So the house consumes 1 kilowatt, which is generated from solar panels, and it doesn't consume anything from the grid, and it exports the extra 1 kilowatt to the grid. So the total import from the grid is zero. So this table shows you how the adjustment happens automatically. The most important thing is, this is how the synchronization works. The solar on-grid inverter, the solar power is pushed inside the utility first, which are your loads, and the rest comes from the EP if there's a deficit in the solar generation. So with respect to on-grid versus off-grid, off-grid system can work with or without the availability of the grid. Grid system requires grid, that's a drawback. Off-grid system requires battery bank, where the on-grid doesn't require battery bank. Hence, the cost of the solar plant is less. The ROI is much faster. So 80% or more than 80% of the plants are on-grid, because that's that is the volumes in the solar market. Let's say anything about 2-3 kilowatt, if everything is on-grid, this thing, even a 10, 20, 30, 50. Imagine if you install 100 kilowatt with a battery-based system, the cost would be very high and there'll be no good, interesting ROI. So the whole reason for corporates, factories installing the on-grid system is because of the ROI story. And you can't export power in the off-grid system. Yeah, we do have a technology called hybrid system, which would have a battery storage, would also export power from the inverter, and it will work as an on-grid as well. So, but this system, depending on your states, let's say Tamil Nadu policy doesn't allow a hybrid system, so other states may allow. So we have to be careful in choosing a hybrid system. So off-grid systems are more convenient when you need a power backup. Let's say you have a lot of power cuts and there is no other option, then I would suggest to go for an off-grid system for smaller capacities. If it's a bigger capacity, let's say you're doing a commercial office space where the requirement is around 10 kilowatt plus, or let's say exactly 10 kilowatt. What you could do is plan 8 kilowatt on-grid and plan 2 kilowatt off-grid. So you have 2 kilowatt off-grid system to run your light, fans, your Wi-Fi, your servers, your PCs during a power cut, so that at least you'll have the efficiency running during a power cut, plus will be savings. And the balance 8 kilowatt system could compensate your air conditioner bills. So the proper mix and match would be ideal for commercial places. Even same could be good for your residences. So let's come back to the basics again. I'm refreshing the basics. As we learned, 4.5 units per kilowatt from an on-grid system, approximate space of 80 square feet, and net meter authorized by TNEB or the MES, which records the exported power. So the ordinary meter are a unidirectional meter, so that would not record the exported power. So we need a bidirectional meter to record the exported power. And in TNEB, the commercial tariff is 8 plus taxes, which comes to 8 rupees 50 paisa. And remember, we have 25 years warranty on the solar panels. Please do review us on our Google page or on our website pertaining to this 2 days training workshop. Okay. Why would anybody would like to own a solar power plant for your home or office? Typically, all the answers are correct. It saves your electricity bills, stepping towards green energy. It reduces your ambient temperature below the solar roof. So let's say your ambient temperature is around 30, 32 degrees, and if you install a solar panel on that roof, your ambient temperature will come down by 3 to 4 degrees, which means it will indirectly reduce your air conditioner load. So before designing the solar power plant, in the next session, we would understand why a customer or the what are the marketing essentials required to convince a customer to install a solar power plant. Let's take an example of a 30 kilowatt plant. This is on a school terrace. I've taken an average example. I've not taken any industry which is running 24/7, 365 days. I've taken an average example or the least example. Well, suppose to be a school where you have 100 holidays in a year. So let's say a school needs a 30 kilowatt plant and which will cost you around 15 lakhs, somewhere around 50,000 rupees per kilowatt, and a terrace area of 3,000 square feet, considering all movements, all maintenance, everything. So the school works for 265 days, 100 days, clear holidays. What will be the savings per year? And considering the new policy, which is net feed-in. So if they consume, self-consume 30 kilowatt into 4.5 units at 8 rupees for 265 days, they would save around 2,86,000 per year. And the exported power for those 100 days, which would be your Sundays or summer holidays, that would be calculated at 2 rupees 8 paisa, and prior it was around 2 rupees 28 paisa. So that would be a minimum value of 30,000 rupees per year. So the total EV saving would be around 3.17 lakhs per year. So if you multiply this number by 5 years, so you get a return of 15.8 lakhs in 5 years. So typically the ROI here works out around 5 years for a school. So we have not considered any inflations over here, neither the interest on the project. So the interest on the project, let's say we get a funding of around 8 to 10% on the project cost, that would be nullified by the inflation of the EV cost in the next 5 years. So maximum returns will not cost more than 5 years. Now let's say that's not a school, that's a commercial establishment where they are paying taxes. Then we have this 40% accelerated depreciation solar benefit given by income tax provision section 34(2)(a), in which any commercial company, could be a factory or could be a tax paying company, they can utilize this AD benefit where they could save around 3.5 lakhs in the first 3 years on their income tax what they pay. So the saving in first 5 years, what you have seen is 15.8 lakhs. Now, if you consider this 3.5 lakh saving, your net investment becomes 11.5 lakhs. So if AD is applicable, then the return on investment is around 28%, or much, much faster. If AD is not applicable, then it's 20%, right? So which means if AD is applicable, your ROI becomes less than 4 years. So these are the essential things when we propose a project to any commercial client. This is how we have to propose. These are the generation figures. These are the benefits what you get from the savings. This is the AD depreciation. This is how the total AD depreciation is calculated. Year 1, year 2, year 3. So very simple calculation. So you will get this figure of 3.5 lakhs. So ROI break-even payback. Let's say the same what I have discussed, 15 lakhs. Depreciation benefit of 3 pence at 11.4. Here, in the payback calculation, I have considered around 50 paisa increase in unit every year. Fine. Mr. Hari, point taken, point noted. So if you give this kind of breakup, considering 50 paisa increase every year from 8.5, next year it would be 9. At the end of 6th year, it becomes 11 rupees. You could imagine the inflation after 5 or 6 years, you'll be paying 11 rupees per unit. Now it would be much higher than that. So that's the pessimistic number what you have taken, 50 paisa increase per year. So that your solar break-even becomes attractive 3 to 4 years. So which is the best investment in the market? Can you quickly type in the chat box? Many have answered shares and mutual funds. Yes, considering the last 1 year scenario, shares is the best investment. It depends time to time, yes. But shares are not predictable. Gold and silver, yes, it's in long term a good investment. But I would say solar is one of the good investments because we know the numbers. There is no ups and downs in solar. Steadily every year you save, and which is consistent. So when you compare this to an FD, which is much, much better. So consider an example. You approach a school most of the schools, colleges are trust-based. So most of the trusts will have a lot of corpus funds landed in the fixed deposit where they are getting a return of 7%. Now, what would I say to this customer is, sir, you have a roof, you have a requirement for energy. And if we get this energy from the solar plant, obviously that money would give you much higher returns than your fixed deposits. It would be at least 2 to 3 times more. So let's say you invest 5.3 lakhs at 7% for 25 years, you will yield only 25 lakhs post tax in a fixed deposit. But when you invest in solar plant, it becomes 45 lakhs. So that is how the return doubles in solar compared to the fixed deposit. That's a very simple key factor to educate the trust of people who have money in their FD. So the thing is, we should advise school colleges to go for solar plants if they have excess money in FD. Now, so we have seen the ROI story. How do we explain to the customer on the ROI of the solar plant? Now, how do we find out what should be the number of units required for that customer? That's more important. Now, we are talking about surveying a site. We are talking about identifying reading the EV bills, so that we could propose a plan size to them, right? So check their EV cards. What do you have to check in the EV cards? You have to check whether it's a single phase or a three phase connection. What is the sanction load from the MES or TNEB? What is the tariff they are paying? So you have residential tariff, commercial tariff, factory tariff. You have temporary construction tariff. So we have to check the rates, what is there? And then whether it's an HT or an LD, high tension or a low tension line, and average monthly units. So this is the most important factor. You have to find out the average monthly units. So when I go here, so this is a monthly bill. On the monthly bill, these are the consumed units. Okay, let's see pre-solar installation. So this is a bill of a school. They were utilizing around 5,000, 7,000, 4,000, 5,000, 7,000 units per month. So let's say, and they were paying somewhere around 68,000 to 70,000, 45,000. So let's say an average of 50,000 rupees monthly, the EV bill was, right? And from 5,000 units. So this 5,000 units have become zero under the old policy, which is the net metering policy. So it's an under net metering policy. So to make this 5,000 units to zero, what would be the approximate size of the plant? The approximate size of the plant, it's very simple to calculate. So I'm making 5,000 units in 30 days. So 5,000 units divided by 30 days and then divided by 4.5. That would give you the exact number, the size of the plant. Right? So I'll repeat, 5,000 units are the monthly units. So 5,000 units divided by 30 days. So you will get number of units per day divided by 4.5 units per kilowatt. So that would be giving you the size of the solar plant. So typically, this is around a 32 to 35 kilowatt plant size. So Now, installation could be in different formats. Basically, the structures based on the space given by the clients. It could be on the roof, 1 feet.
Can you repeat the plan size calculation? Like total number of units consumed in a year?
I'll do that. I'll go to this. Fine. So, let's, from this AP bill, the customer was using around 5,000 units.
Okay.
5,000 units, which is evident over here. They have taken the average, right? Okay. And then he was paying around 50,000 rupees average for 5,000 units. Now, this 5,000 units were consumed in 30 days.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, divide by 30, 5,000 divided by 30. What is the answer? And then divide by number of units. It could be 4 units or 4.5 units or 5 units based on the panel technology. If you use a monopurp, if you use a polycrystalline, for easier calculation, just divide by 4 units. So you get the solar plant size. What is the answer, sir?
41.5,
right? Yeah. So you are divided by 4.
After dividing by 4.
Okay. So, 4 is the generation for what we have seen yesterday, 4 units per kilowatt from an on-grid system.
Okay.
So, this could vary from place to place. It could be 4.5, it could be 5 if you are using high efficient solar panels, right? Fine. Thank you. So, this is how we arrive on the solar plant size. So, based on the customer's requirement, the panels could be elevated, or it could be mounted on the shed, or it could be on your roof. We have different types of customized installation based on the requirement of the client. If they don't want to lose a terrace area, typically for smaller residences or a smaller office, they could elevate the panel at 10 feet height, and that could be used as a roof for dining or for some other gathering activities. Something like this, 10, 12 feet height on the GI sheet. And the entire area becomes free. Or in a school, elevated solar shed. Other activity, it can be placed for other activities. So we do have a YouTube channel. Please do subscribe so that you could get updated on whatever video we share pertaining to the solar technology. Now, do we have any doubts till now on the on-grid system? Because before starting the next session, any doubts?
Yinder, can I talk?
Yes, please.
Yeah. See, now actually you told monthly consumption units divided by 30 days divided by unit generation of the cell. Now, this 5,000 units is the 24 hours consumption. It means day shift will be there, night shift will be there. So you can take this pattern only day shift, because we are going to pump the unit from the day shift.
Correct.
Because of the sun available. So
correct.
The consumption has to take the pattern of only day, because
correct.
The night shift, because the nowadays TNAB recording the complete slab of the hours. You know the tabs, C1, C2, C slots available.
Yes.
So they will not consider for even the net metering. We can't able to consider. So only can take the day shift reading and then we can compensate. That will give us a good yield.
Correct. So coming to Mr. Ravi's point, let's say if you have a daytime industry or a school which works in the daytime, that was an average of 5,000 units. Let's take an example of a residence, right? Let's say a residence consumes around 20 units in 24 hours. If you see in residence, the 20 units is not utilized in the daytime. Only 30% or 20% of the units is utilized in the daytime based on the occupancy. So if I plan for a residence, I'll plan only for 25 to 30%. Let's say I'll plan only for 5 units. Right?
Yes.
So five units, I would plan only a 1.5 kilowatt system. The reason is because of the policy. If I install that 20 unit system, what happens? I have to export the excess power out, because I'll be consuming only 5 units in the daytime, which is the sunlight time, which is from 8 o'clock to 5:30 or 5 o'clock. I'll be consuming only 5 units during that time. And the other 15 units, which is generated in the same daytime, it gets exported out. So in Tamil Nadu, if I export that out for that moment, it will be recorded as an export. So for 15 units, Tamil Nadu government or TNEB will be paying us 2.08 rupees, which means they'll be paying 30 rupees, which is not viable, against the investment, right? So in Tamil Nadu, if you're planning based on the policy, you have to plan only for your self-consumption use, which is in the daytime. So do note that. So we have to find from the customer, if you're not working, if you're working for 24/7, find what is the daytime load. So if it's a big industry, then we have this data loggers, or you record the energy metering, morning units, evening units for 1 week's time, and then they take the average daytime consumption and then size your plant. And typically, let's say I size a plant of around 40 kilowatt, then I should also know what is the area required. So 40 kilowatt into 80 square feet. So somewhere close to 3,200 square feet area, shadow free, south facing, I require on the terrace. So we have to also size on that. Let's say I don't have 3,200 square feet. The client gives me only 1,500 square feet. Then because of the space limitation, I'll be planning only for 1,500 square feet, close to around 20 kilowatt. I can't put a 40 kilowatt plant. So that's how the limitation of the site. Any other questions before we take a break and then start?
Sir, this EB reading also they taken by bimonthly basis only, no, sir. That's why we have to convert this average unit divided by 30 days. No, you have to mention, no.
Sir, come again.
That EB reading also taken for bimonthly basis, no. 2 months once only the EB rating also taken, no. But you are for this calculation, average unit divided by 30 days, you are making, no. That's why I'm asking.
Okay, I'll tell you the reason. This is an LT meter. The starting, if you see the assessment date, every month the reading has come, fine. So this is a monthly meter. Did you note, sir, assessment dates? Okay. Yeah. So in TNAB, if you are not falling under LT or HT, what I mean to a LT LTCT meter or a HT meter, which are monthly readings, right? If you're falling only under LT meters, which are less than this thing, 60 kilowatt sanction load. Your residences, your 20 kilowatt small commercial office, that will be a bi-monthly reading. So in that case, you have to divide by 60 days. And to be more precise, let's say if it's an office, fine, and the bills are coming bi-monthly, 60 days bills. In that, you have to eliminate your holidays. Let's say you're not working on Sundays. So you have 8 Sundays in 60 days, right? Let's say we have 2,000 average bi-monthly units. You have to divide 2,000 divided by 52, not by 60. Because 8 days I'm not working, I've never used energy for an office scenario. Clear?
Okay.
Any other questions?
Yeah. Yes.
Please, sir.
Yeah, I'm Gauri Shankar here. Gauri Shankar here. Okay. What will be the loss of percentage or the efficiency if the panel is not placed in south side? If it is placed in the north side, what could be the generation or in the loss of percentage?
So typically the loss would be somewhere around 10 to 15% if your panels are facing north side. And if the inclination in the north is more, let's say you're installing cases of factories where you have this A-type sheds and would be around 30 degrees or 25 degrees. So if you're placing on the north side, what happens? Your loss will be somewhere around 15%, 30 degrees slope. If it's exactly a 10 degree slope, the loss would be around 10-12%. But in those scenarios, if you don't have any other options, then customer is informed about that loss, or you can plan 10% more panels if the space is available.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, I have a question here.
Yes, sir.
If you are planning to have a charging station for a battery bikes, like either two wheeler or three wheeler, whatever the which runs on battery, for how do you calculate the panel, like what KV needs to be installed for charging that, and what will be the optimum solution for it? Say in daytime the vehicle is running, and evening once after the business is done, they come and park the vehicle in the parking lot where we have a charging station. So it will be like we'll have a battery backup, so that from once the solar power is getting charging, solar power is charging the battery, and from charge battery we are charging the e-vehicle.
Right, got it. So basically this is a standalone system. Simple example I will give you, this is equivalent to a solar street light, right? So the charging of battery happens in the daytime and you're discharging in the night time, right? So here in this case, you have to charge the batteries, the e-vehicle batteries or the e-vehicles from the stored energy, from the battery, right? So typically based on the battery size, let's say if you have 100, for example, if you have 100 Ah, or say in battery sizing 5 kilowatt hour, 10 kilowatt hour. So we have to consider the load of the battery, and you have to use the battery load calculation to size the solar panel. Let's say, for example, if I have an 100 Ah battery, 100 Ah battery, and if I have a 100 watt panel,
okay,
and if I have 10 hours of good sunlight,
mm-hmm,
I could charge my 100 Ah battery fully. Right? But what happens? We don't have a control on the 10 hours sunlight.
Mm-hmm.
It could be cloudy, or it could be bright for 30 days in a year, and it would be cloudy for a few days in years. What I'll do is I'll overrate the solar panel. What I'll do is I'll put a 150 watt panel to charge my 100 Ah battery. This is for one time charge. Because as in your application, you'll be using it only in the night time.
Mm-hmm.
And it'll be,
it's not necessarily night time. Probably somewhere one or a couple of hours in the day, like around like say in the afternoon, like from 3 to 5 or something, after that in the night. So like, do we have any specification that we need to check on the e-vehicle's battery capacity?
No, see, e-vehicle's battery capacity will vary from manufacturer to manufacturer, right? You will have a 48 volt 40H battery, you will have a 72 volt 60H battery, you will have a 24 volt battery. Right. Okay. So our charging station have to be universal. It has to be on different DC voltages. It should be able to charge 12 volt, 24 volt, 48 volt, 72 volt, and 96 volt batteries will also be available for e-vehicles. So okay, this will be the universal charging station. So what is common for us is the battery bank. Let's say you have a battery bank of around 20 kilowatt hour.
Okay.
20 kilowatt hour storage. For 20 kilowatt hour storage, one time charging, one time discharging, we know the solar plant size, right? So you could install that kind of plant. If you're charging in many times, so you need more solar panels, which means if I'm charging my e-vehicle in the daytime itself, which is a daytime load, right? So the solar panel directly gets fed to the e-vehicle battery. This is how we have to design. In such cases, if you have a grid option, then I would suggest go for an on-grid system, mm-hmm, with the grid interference, so that your efficiency will be much higher. And also you'll be having a flexibility to charge the batteries in the night, considering e-vehicles. The flexibility will be more. In remote areas where we don't have grid at all, then the off-grid is the solution. Fine.
Okay. And one more thing is like in the rooftop, you told we'll have that galvanized sheet, and now above that we'll be installing the panel. Is there a latest technology or solution where instead of having the galvanized, we'll directly have the solar panels?
There's a company called Atom Visakha from Hyderabad, where okay, the solar panels integrated with the cement board. So that is the only company doing that. So you can check with those companies for such installations. You can avoid the shift.
Okay. So in that, the lifetime of the solar panel will be same as the normal thing, like.
Yes, they claim it is same. They also give a warranty for 25 years. But only the challenge is we are not sure. This is the only one company. But they have good reviews on Google. You can check on that. So we'll conclude here now. We'll join after 10 minutes. Fine?
Yeah, thank you.
We'll join after 10 minutes, take a break and come back. Meantime, I'll just record the session. Thank you.